This is episode 102 of the Reading Cove Book Club's podcast. If you're a book lover who may be interested in joining an online book club, please visit our website at thereadingcove.com to learn more about our group. For May 2019, we're discussing The Glass Ocean by Beatriz Williams, Karen White, and Lauren Willig. So hi, I'm Millenia in Vietnam.
I'm Roberta in Georgia.
And Roberta and I are two members of the Reading Cove Book Club, and today we're here to discuss our group's 222nd pick, The Glass Ocean. And this was chosen by our very own Roberta.
Yes.
So I just finished the book today, like under the wire, so everything is really, really fresh in my mind. And I know that you read it a while ago.
Yes.
You're a huge fan of all three authors. Yes. And we've read Karen White in the group before. I think we've read at least one of her books before.
Yes.
So this one we haven't heard yet. I think today we heard from Erin that she really liked it. I think she gave it a B. Haven't really heard yet from the rest of the members. And today we'll be starting our discussion with everyone else in the group online. So as for me, my bottom line is I really am not a huge fan of romanticized disaster books. It's like this romanticized the sinking of the torpedoing, I should say, of the Lusitania. And I don't like it. It was more about the romances between the guy Robert Langdon on the ship and how he was trying to seduce Caroline, and then his relationship with Tess, who was the other narrator, because it's narrated by three women, Caroline, Tess, and Sarah in the present day. And then Sarah's relationship with his great-grandson, John, when she went to England. It was really more about that, and then the tragedy just felt like, and the whole forgery thing, Tess was trying to forge this waltz, and then the espionage, the mystery about what was going on with Robert and Gilbert, Caroline's husband, all of that just felt like it was kind of secondary to the romantic relationships, which weren't that interesting for me. I don't know. What did you think?
Well, you know, I like historical romance stuff. I like the little romance mixed mm-hmm. in, but that's just me.
And yeah, but it wasn't mixed in. That's my point. It wasn't mixed in. That's what it was about.
Well, these authors, their books focus more on relationships and romance and things.
Right.
And they have, then there's a storyline. Each one of them had a lot of times will have historical parts of the books, you know, sometimes present day, sometimes the past, and sometimes a combination of both, as in this book. And as we've said before, I like historical fiction, so I always learn a little bit more, because before reading this book, I really didn't know any more except, oh, the Lusitania was sunk, you know, and it was a very tragic thing, and, you know, it got everybody stirred up because it was just a passenger liner. I had nothing to do with the war or
right.
anything.
Mm-hmm.
It was like a real affront and a call to arms. And also, I didn't know. I thought this was, you know, like some of these other type of ships. I thought everybody was killed. But then I found out through this book that there were some survivors. So,
yeah,
you always something new, but you just don't get taught that much except Lusitania was torpedoed and, mm-hmm. you know, it was a big mess and everything, and had a big impact on the war and all.
Yeah. I mean, the things that I liked, I was more interested in what might have been going on and who was a mole and who was a spy and who wasn't. I was more interested in that. So I ended up being really, really bored as it spent pages and pages and pages just kind of living in the space of these relationships.
Right.
You know, and it was just so very predictable. Oh, I didn't see Caroline choosing to be with her husband, because that was the other thing that really annoyed me. This was an eye-rolling moment. The whole time they were on the ship, up until like the last 2 days or so, Gilbert, Caroline's husband, was being very dismissive of her. Very, oh, he has a meeting to go to. He wasn't spending any time with her. He was completely neglecting her. And that just made it really easy for her to be susceptible to falling for this other guy, Robert
right.
Langford. Then all of a sudden, she sleeps with Robert, and then her husband does a 180. All of a sudden, the very next morning, he's back in love with her again. The very next morning, he's back in love with her. He's showering her with attention. He's willing to open up to her because she was feeling very left out and like he was just keeping everything secret and not including her in his life. And then the next day, boom, he completely changed and there didn't seem to be any real reason for the change. I didn't get it. And then suddenly he became this noble character. Like, oh, he had actually invented this new alloy material and he was protecting it. And I did think it was clever that Tess was on there to forge this waltz because they, her sister Ginny, they thought, you know, it was valuable and all of that. And that was just a ruse.
Right.
So I thought that was very clever. But I wanted more of that. I guess that's why I was kind of bored.
The details behind the story.
Yeah, I mean, wanted more on that.
It was interesting about the, and Tess, you know, she was a very clever person, even though she got sort of played too by these things. But
by her sister, right? And then her sister just kind of ran off and abandoned her at the end because she was going to be in trouble.
Right. Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. But I mean, and her sister tried to tell her, oh, well, if we do this one more thing, then we won't have to do this anymore.
Anymore. And yeah. This will be our last hurrah.
Yeah. Because you get the feeling at first that Gilbert's up to no good. And like you said, here he and Caroline are supposed to be going on this cruise to help their marriage and everything.
That's what she thought. That's what she thought.
Well, I mean, and that's what, you know, that he was trying to say, oh, we can do this and, you know, it'll be good. But I think it was another one of these marriages back in that time where it was just sort of expected, you expected to marry someone of the same class that had money and every prospects, but.
No, but it turned out that they would have stayed together if he hadn't died. Like, it's like they really rediscovered each other all of a sudden. And then I'm trying to explain it. I'm like, okay, did he know that she slept with Robert? And then that's what made him suddenly, I don't know. It was weird.
Yeah, well, maybe it's not really explained, but maybe he's thinking he doesn't want to lose her, even though he hasn't been really paying her that much attention, not just on the ship, but in, you know, previously. So maybe he was all of a sudden worried, well, I've just taken her for granted and I'm going to lose her if I don't do something and pay her more attention, be more like a good husband.
Yeah. It was just kind of whiplashy. Before he was acting like, I'm thinking, okay, he must be cheating on her or he must be gay or, you know, it's like, why is he treating her like this? And then all of a sudden, oh no, I really love you and I'm going to, you know, here, let me tell you what I'm up to. It was just kind of whiplash. Anyway, so then they kind of rediscover each other. She's tickled pink about it. And I guess, you know, okay, forget about Robert. Bye.
You were just a one-night stand.
Man. He was just a one-night stand to fill the emptiness. Because I'm a neglected wife, right? And then, okay, so she's, you know, sending a note. And that's the other thing. Yes, they had to communicate through their ladies' maids and their stewards or whatever. So they're sending, you know, notes. But I just kept thinking, really? Really? You're going to trust these people with this information?
I wouldn't.
I wouldn't either. I'd have to find a way to give it to him myself.
that was just, you know, how the times were.
Yeah. And then I did think Caroline was really stupid. Oh, yeah. When she came back from sleeping with Robert and then Jones, her lady's maid, was waiting for her in the dark and scared the crap out of her in her room. And then she says, oh, you know, Gilbert, your husband wants the waltz. And I thought, no, don't.
Don't do it.
So she goes to the safe and takes it out and gives it to the lady's maid. This very valuable thing. I'm like, really? How come you be so stupid? And it turns out the lady's maid was Ginny.
Right.
Yeah, I was like, Caroline, how dumb can you be? She was a little dumb.
Too naive and trusting.
Exactly. Very naive. But yeah, those, you know, that was the most interesting part for me. And then as far as the present day with Sarah and John, very boring. The most, for me, the most interesting part was, you know, at the end when she, you know, they kind of split up for 2 years and she wrote the book, and it was surprising to find that she had written the book about Caroline and her music and not, you know, about, you know, everything they were researching and whatnot. That was was interesting, but you know, yeah, that was that for me. So for me, I give it a C plus.
I gave it a B plus, but that's just me.
Yeah, I think most people in the group should like it.
Right, it does have history, which we read a lot of historical books in the Cove over the years for sure.
Mm-hmm. I think it has an advantage in that way with fiction, because when things are set in present day, unless you're setting it in a different culture or maybe in the military or something that is different to most people, you don't really have the opportunity to make them feel transported unless the setting is really unique. So with historical fiction, it's a given that the author needs to make you feel that you're in that time.
Uh-huh.
So I think that's the one of the big advantages it has.
It is.
Yep. So any other thoughts?
Pretty much hit the highlights and everything. And,
yeah.
We'll have to see what the rest of the group thinks about it. But I'm glad I picked it, and I'm glad the group read it. So it may not be everybody's personal favorite, but I think it had a lot to offer on some levels. So
yeah, I agree. I think that it's the first book I've ever read about the Lusitania.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think it does have a lot to offer in that sense. So we'll see what everyone thinks. Are there, since you read it such a while ago, are there any scenes that stand out for you now that you remember?
Well, I guess just, you know, finding out about Tess, how good she was at doing, you know, all these different types of forgeries.
Mm-hmm.
That you just think she's just a typical woman, you know, not high class, but sort of, you know, lower class and all that. But then you find out, even though she's using it for bad, but she truly has a gift, and you hope sometime in the future, if she doesn't go away to jail or die, that she'll be able to use it for good.
Well, she did, because
I know, but I'm just saying, when you the first hint that you find out she's doing,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm,
then it's kind of thinking, oh, well, that's a surprise.
Yeah,
you don't think that when you first meet her, when she's first introduced.
Yeah, when she's first introduced, you kind of just think, okay, she's a con artist. She's, right. She's up to no good. But then as you get to know her, you realize that the sister is the one who's up to no good.
Right, and Tess has sort of been sort of looped into this whole mess and everything.
Mm-hmm. And it turns out the sister was being conned herself.
Right. They weren't really victims. They just made some really bad choices. I guess more because they felt like that was, you know, the way they could survive when in tough times.
And then, of course, Tess goes on to marry Robert.
Right.
The whole thing was really weird.
It was, but, you know, weirder things have happened. So.
I know.
That was sort of a surprise.
She and Caroline ended up helping each other when the ship, you know, was sinking. And then, of course, Caroline went on to, after Gilbert died, she married a childhood friend and had been pregnant with Robert's child.
Right. So that was sort of a twist, too. But
yeah. And another twist was that Sarah, in the modern day, she was actually the great-granddaughter of Patrick and not either of the Langfords or Caroline.
Right.
Because I was thinking she was Caroline's great-granddaughter.
Right, right.
So that was a twist as well.
Right, yeah. Sometimes you go looking, like all these things now with Ancestry.com, sometimes you go looking for things. Things turn out a lot different from what you thought.
Alrighty, so that's going to be our discussion of The Glass Ocean by Beatriz Williams, Karen White, and Lauren Willig. Stay tuned for our next discussion. Next time, we will be discussing At the Water's Edge by Sarah Gruen. See you next time. Thanks for listening. Bye.
Bye.